When we think about the book of Acts, we think about this title, what's in a name? What's in a name? You know, our names are incredibly important because it represents a part of our identity. Our names carry deep personal, cultural, and family and historical connections. If you were to go back and do a historicity of your name, you'll find that you can go back and your name is connected to some other people, some other geographies. Your name. There's a rich history behind your name. You may even go back and find that sometimes your name is not just connected with your ethnicity, that it will cross over to other ethnicities because there's power in that name. One reason our names are important is because this is how people can get our attention. My. See, majority of the time when people want us or they need our attention, they'll call our name. They'll shout out our name. John! To get your attention. They won't send you a text. When they really want you, they really need you, they'll call on your name. And when you think about this call, say something about the call of the name. In Hebrew, the word translated as call is the English, which means to call out to or cry unto. When we're calling on the Lord Jesus Christ, we're calling out to or we're crying unto. We're calling on his name. When we think about that in the Hebrew, the Greek word means to invoke a person, to call a person just simply by their name. When I think about the names of our Lord Jesus Christ, if there's anyone that I want to be able to grab the attention, is him. Because we can call on a lot of names of some folks. But sometimes when you call on some folks' names, sometimes they don't respond. Help me, Holy Ghost. You can sit there and pretend that every time you call on the name of someone, they always answer you. But if the truth be told, we put our hand on our heart, you know in your history there's time where you called on someone. You needed someone. You called on them and they were not there. The key is when we call on the Lord Jesus Christ, he will always be there. He will never leave us nor forsake us. When we think about this thing, for example, when a little child falls on their knees and scrape their knees, more often than not, they're going to cry out, Mommy! They're going to cry out for their mother. And their mother, when they hear that voice, there's something about a mother when she hears the cry of her child. It'll cause her to leap over a bus. She will go through a brick wall when she hears the voice of her child. And she will do whatever she has to get to them. Because when she comes, she's coming to soothe them, she's coming to comfort them, and she's coming to wrap them with love and let them know it's going to be all right. The child knows this themselves. They know that there's security when that help is on the way. Lord have mercy. See, when you, in some way, when we cry out to the Lord, that lets us know that he is our God, our Father. And when he hears our voice, he knows that we're spiritually or emotionally hungry or there's something going on. See, sometimes we don't call on the name of the Lord when everything's going right. Okay, amen. I said, we don't call on the name of the Lord like we ought to when everything's going right. When everything's going right, what I mean, all your bills are paid. Nothing is behind. You're paying off stuff. You just burned your mortgage because you paid it off. It's a celebratory time, but do you really cry out in the name of the Lord like you need to? The only time we really cry out for him is when we are hurting, when we're in a desperate situation, when we tried to handle it ourselves and find out I'm really in trouble. That's when we want to call on his name. So we are strategic about when we want to call on his name. And God says, you ought to be calling on my name in the good times and the bad. If we're smart, we'll call on his name a lot more in the good times because we know the bad is on its way. When you look at this thing here, God says that when you call on the name of the Lord, it literally defines and let us know that it's an audible thing that we have to do. It's not a silent thing. When I want the Lord's attention, I'll cry out. Have you ever had a moment in your walk with him where you had to cry out to the Lord? Where you just sat before him and wept, crying out for relief, crying out for comfort, crying out for an answer, crying out for healing. Have you ever been there when the tears flowed down the side of your face? And there was no one there that's a human that was able to comfort you. Okay, amen, lights and walls. Maybe you haven't been there, but I have. So much so you're weeping that you can't even see the words in the Bible. Because you need the Lord to show you, God, which direction am I to go? When I look at this, his full name, the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus, this is not an accident that it's worded that way. Because you know that when you're talking about this thing, when you cry out on the Lord, there's things are going to change. Look, when you think about this in the book of Acts, you remember Paul and Silas was incarcerated in the prison because they healed and delivered a woman, a young girl, of a demon and sort of messed up the flow of the money for the people that were using her. My. And they were thrown in the prison. It is said that when they were in the prison, they begin to go through a lot of pain and anguish, but in spite of all of that, they had a praise break. They had a praise break being shackled in the prison. They called on the name of the Lord, and they let their praises be lifted up in the dark, shallow places of that prison. So much so that when they did that, the Lord moved on their behalf. See, when you call on him, there's going to be a response. It may not be like you want it, but there's going to be a response. God will make a way out of no way. If God can shake a building and cause the doors and the shackles of the prison to unlock and drop off, don't you think he can handle your problem? When you look at what happened, it's not easy to be going through pain in the midnight hour. It's not easy to have a song in the night. But when you look at Psalm chapter 42, verse 8, we find that God does have a song for you too. He says the Lord will command his loving kindness in the daytime, and in the night his song shall be with me. Lord have mercy. A prayer to the God of my life. See, God can sing a melody to you that can put you to sleep, that can give you some peace, to let you know it's going to be all right. When I look at this, God says sometimes when you look at this, that it's going to affect other people based on the name you're calling on. So the question I have to ask you is, when people are looking at you and experiencing you, whose name do they most often hear you call out? Who are you talking about most? Because the name that should be seen or heard the most would be the Lord Jesus Christ. How do I know it's important? Because remember, when they were in the prison, the jailer heard what was going on. The jailer was so impressed that he had a change of attitude. And the very man that probably beat them began to wash their wounds. Look at that. How God changed behavior. See, when true repentance comes, there ought to be a desire and a love to have reparations and restitution to the person we hurt. Okay, help me, Holy Ghost. See, when we look at this, we should not only wash another person's feet, but we should also cleanse the wounds that we have given to people. Because there's some things that we've done to one another that God says you ought to make right. When you look at this, God says there may be times in your life like Paul and Silas when you might feel imprisoned. You need to be reminded to call on the name of the Lord. Listen, if you're ever in prison in the relationship, you need to cry out and begin praising and praying to the Lord. If you're ever in a situation where it's a financial hardship, you ought to begin praising and worshiping the Lord. If there's a situation where you're going through imprisonment on your job, a dead-end opportunity, you ought to begin praising and lifting up the Lord. When you're going through something that's hard as a parent-child relationship, it's fractured, you ought to begin praying and singing to the Lord. God is showing us in this text that Luke wrote, there are three things we want to take a look at and unpack. And that is, we want to look at the Lord Jesus Christ's name and what it means for us. Three things I want to look at and get out your way. One, I'm going to look at the Lord, the heavenly title. Then I want to look at Jesus, the human title. Then I want to look at Christ, the Hebrew title, if you want to walk with me. Our first point is the Lord, the heavenly title, Lord Jesus. When you look at the Lord, in the Greek it means Kyrios. This is the title that speaks of Jesus' deity. It literally commands the fact that he is part of the Trinity. It's the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And you look at this, it lets us know that the Lord has that position, that title, because of where he rests in the Godhead. My. See, when you look at this, the Godhead essentially saying that they're all three co-equal, co-eternal, and the same in substance, but distinct in subsistence as it is with the Father and the Holy Ghost. When you think about the Trinitarian doctrine, that's why we ought to never forget who we're talking to, because he is part of the Godhead. When we acknowledge him, we ought to acknowledge him as the eternal one, the righteous one, the glorious one, because that's the role that he plays. When I look at this, it's talking about this, some people will try to do whatever they can to deny his deity. They say he was not God in the flesh. Some of people might even try to resort to science to try to and reason to try to refute his deity. I want you to know, science and reason can't even begin to wade in the water where faith can swim. See, when we have faith in who he is, we can do magnificent things. The key is going to be, can I trust in who he is with the faith that I have? That means when I look at this, I have to know that when I look at the deity of our Lord, we must comprehend that the Father, literally, the great upholder, the one that's the purpose of all things, comes behind the Son, who is the Redeemer of humanity. He is our Redeemer. I said, he is our Redeemer. I said, the Lord, his heavenly title. That's the only way you and I were saved, because of what he was able to do at Calvary's cross. See, we should never, ever take for granted that he took our place at Calvary's cross. Okay, amen. Have you ever been blamed for something you didn't do? If you can think about that, how did it make you feel? More often than not, you didn't feel good when you were blamed for something you did not do. Well, think about what Jesus did. He came from the portals of glory, wrapped himself up in humanity, walked amongst us, was accused, was portrayed, was beaten, was jailed, all manner of things done to him, and he did it willingly for you and I. See, we would do something like that possibly, I said possibly, for a friend or a brother or sister, but we certainly wouldn't do it for our enemy. Y'all ain't praying with me. See, okay, amen. You would give your last to your enemy. The person that don't like you, the person that betrayed you, the person that stabbed you in the back, the person that talked about you, you would give your last piece of income to. Okay, amen. I got one person that's being honest in the back. The reality is that we would not do that because our natural tendency is not to yield that way. Our natural proclivity is want to get back at them. If anything, we're going to take joy that they're going through some hardship. The reality is that Jesus is our Redeemer, and the Holy Ghost is our sanctifier and our enlightener. So when we think about the God of the Godhead, we're talking about the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Jesus, his name, his title, Lord, says, I'm right where I need to be. And so when you look at this, when we acknowledge the Lord, that means we ought to always acknowledge that title in a very reverence way. When you talk about reverence, that means we're going to do it with some form of fear. Not where I'm afraid, but it's just to be able to honor who he is. Think about this, my brothers and sisters. When you think about the name that you can call on, the Lord Jesus Christ. See, you can't just call on his name and then be doing a whole lot of other things. Amen. See, it gets you an opportunity to put a searchlight on yourself and say, how am I living? Because it's a reality check. When you call on the Lord himself, when you think about this, we want to acknowledge him because of his power and his authority. Think about his attributes. The Lord being deity means he's immutable. That means he never changes. We change, but he never changes. When we think about his attributes, he is the only one that's self-sufficient. We are totally dependent on others to live and to move. We're totally dependent. He is, in that title, the one that is omnipotent. My, my, my. He is the one that can do everything and how he wants to, when he wants to. He's the one that's omniscient. He knows everything about you and I. You think about it. What has it been invading your thoughts lately? Because God says, I know your thoughts are far off. My, my, my. The fact that he knows your thoughts are far off ought to make us tremble based on some things that we've been thinking and entertaining. He is also the God that's omnipresent. Everywhere is in his presence. He's not everywhere. Everywhere is in his presence. That's the Lord, his title. That's what he gives to you and I. When we look at that, we call on his name. See, when you look at this in Romans chapter 10, verse 9, it literally said, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. But look at this. He said, when you look at the Bible, it doesn't say receiving Christ as your Savior. It says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. My, my, my. See, salvation is not a cafeteria line. Salvation was never a cafeteria line where we can go in and say, you know what? I'll take a little bit of Savior, but I don't want too much of that Lord. See, over here, Savior, Lord, you make a way for me, you provide for me, you give me things. Over here, nah, you're trying to take too much control. Okay, amen, lights and walls. See, Savior, we can embrace that. Lord means he's Lord over everything. That means you got to submit everything to him. The problem is we like a lot of this cafeteria food. We ain't feeling this over here. These are the hamburgers and fries. This is the spinach. We talk about lordship, lording over, recognizing when I submit to the Lord, I submit to him in totality, not being strategically about when and why I want to do it. See, when you talk about this, see, you cannot have what he gives unless you accept what he is. You can't do that. If we're going to accept who he is, then we got to be able to embrace what he's going to give. The problem is we want to be in control. We're probably thinking right now, why is my life where it is today? Have that question ever crossed your mind? Why am I where I am today? And I was reminded one day when I asked that question, and God says, you are where you are based on the culmination of all your decisions. And yet in spite of that, I'm still in control. My, my, my. That's good news, ladies and gentlemen. That's good news. That in spite of decisions that we made, and Lord have mercy, some of us didn't make some good decisions. Y'all ain't praying with me. See, some of us made some real bad decisions. And yet God said, in spite of your decisions, I'm still going to take care of you. God says, in spite of the way you went left when I told you to go right, I still got your back. God says, I told you don't go in there, but you did anyway. I still got your back. God says, don't embrace that philosophy, and you did anyway. God said, I still got your back. The problem is we try to think that I can know better than what he does, and he's Lord. See, when we look at him, his Lord, that means his heavenly title. That means he knows everything in the beginning. He knows it at the end. He knows it at the beginning. So everything that we are. So he said, if you want what I'm going to give, You got to accept who I am. So he's Lord. That's his heavenly title. Listen, look at the second point. He says Jesus, his human title. Lord have mercy. See, all of these names mean something. Jesus simply means Jehovah is salvation or Jehovah saves. See, when you think about this, the scripture said in Matthew chapter 1, verse 21, and he says, he literally said, and he shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call the name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Jesus is going to save us from our sins. That lets us know that you and I don't have no part in that. So when people, have you ever talked to someone that has an addiction problem? And they'll always say, well, I can stop when I want to. No, you can't. No, you can't. You need a Lord. You need Jesus to take that away from you, to take that taste out of your mouth. We lack the natural proclivity to get rid of it, and we'll always rationalize while we go back as soon as we get a little stress on us. But he said also, his purpose in coming to earth was to provide salvation. How did he do that? If you look at Matthew chapter 20, verse 28, it says here, he said, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. Lord have mercy. See, as Jesus, he let us know that I had to pay a ransom for your humanity to redeem you from the hand of the enemy. I had to pay a costly price. I had to surrender my life for you. For you, Pastor Kevin. I had to surrender my life. Even while we were yet in our sin, Christ died for us. So when you look at Jesus and what he did, it truly means that his death, he died, was substitutionary. He took our spot. Lord have mercy. When I first realized that, I said, Lord Jesus, that means I was destined to die, to be eternally separated from you. But because of who you are, you stepped in my place and took my place. Listen, that's like some you standing in front of a firing squad and they have the rifles aimed at your heart. And just before they pull the trigger, Jesus stepped in a way and moved you out of the way and said, I'm going to take that for you. Think about that for a moment. He was beaten all night long. He was publicly ridiculed, talked about. While in prison, he was blindfolded. He was beaten, closed fists, punched, and they mocking him, saying, if you are a prophet, prophesy who hit you. He's blindfolded, no sleep, up all night because of the brutality of the Roman soldiers. Yet he did that for you and I. But it didn't stop there. He said, not only are we going to brutalize him and physically beat him, but then get the cat of nine tails with the shard of glass and sharp pieces of metal on the end and tie his hands around a stump to then wield it in a very powerful way to whip across his back. And each time they pulled flesh with it to continue to beat him for you and I. He took our place. When you think about the beating, how he did not look probably like himself because he was brutally tortured, beaten up all night, perspiration moving into the wounds. And yet they didn't put this cross on his back and said, march down the Via della Rosa to Calvary because you are going to die because you profess to be the king of the Jews. So he literally did that for you and I. But on the way, he had to pause to demonstrate his divinity. Because when you know he got to a certain point, you had Simon of Cyrene. He had to take that cross from Jesus because the cross was only for criminals and Jesus was not a criminal. See, the cross represent prosecution. He was going there for persecution. So that's why he couldn't carry the cross. So he goes to the cross. He is nailed to the cross. Nailed to the cross for you and I. I need you to get that in your mind. Brutalized, beaten, then nailed to a cross, the most heinous way to die, and then lifted up in between two criminals. Y'all ain't praying with me. I said he did that for you and I. Jesus did that, his human side, his humanity did that for you and I. The fact that he would do this for us is enough to shout. It's enough to get excited. And then he sure enough allowed himself to die. But then after he died, he allowed himself to be buried. But what I love about it is that he said, no man takes my life. I lay it down, and if I lay it down, I can pick it back up. Thank God that he was able to pick up that life again. Thank God that he was not just like a mere man. That in the midst of that, he had to be born and live in as a child in a borrowed feeding trough and be buried in a borrowed grave, lived a life of poverty, still giving to people, healing people in the midst of the brutality he endured. He did that for you and I. I said, Jesus did that for you and I. He took our place, I said, at Calvary's cross. Lord have mercy. See, we ought to think about that every day, not just on Communion Sunday. We should think about what he did for us every day. Never lose sight of what he did, because when we lose sight, we become desensitized to the magnitude of what he did. Help me, Holy Ghost. Listen, there was an example. In 1982, January 13th, there was a situation that occurred where millions of people on TV had an opportunity to watch live a middle-aged man who was in some icy water, swimming, trying to stay afloat. They watched. A rescue helicopter came and was hovering over him while he was in this icy water with the ability to only live for a few moments. They lowered a rope on two different occasions, but he did not grab it. He did not embrace it. He pushed it away. Two times, they watched him become exhausted and then drown on TV. Now, some of us would say, that was a needless death. That was futile. Why wouldn't you grab the rope? Well, we got to have some proper context when you look at that, until you consider the broader picture. See, when I talk about January 13, 1982, there was a Boeing 737 that took off from National Airport in Washington, D.C. During that time, it was a snowstorm. It had snowed 7 inches. And unbeknownst to the pilots, a lot of ice had built up on the wings. When that aircraft took off from the runway, it could not get the altitude that it needed. And as a result, it crashed into the bridge, the Woodrow Wilson Bridge, hitting cars and then going into the Potomac River nose first. There were 83 souls on that aircraft, including the crew. And when it crashed, it submerged immediately. There were some survivors in the water with all the debris, all the luggage, all the broken things and so forth in the water with this middle-aged man. The rescue helicopter did come and lower the rope. When the rope was lowered to him, instead of him taking it, he gave it to someone else so that they could be lifted and taken to safety. He did that twice, denying himself so that someone else can be saved. I want you to know that Jesus Christ did that for us. Listen to me. You can think about it in a light way, but I want you to know, as this man and who he was, denied himself, that he died for two other individuals to be saved. How much more impactful was Christ's death for all of humanity? That he would die for you and I. He would take our place so that we could be redeemed from the hand of the enemy. Listen, knowing that you're redeemed from the power of sin, you're redeemed from the penalty of sin. That's what Christ did for you and I. He took our place. It was substitutionary. This is why we declare that Jesus is the Lamb of God, who was slain for the sins of the world. See, I'm talking about his titles. He is the Lord Jesus. I said he is the Lord, the deity, Jesus, the Lamb of God. But it not only is he the Lord Jesus, but he's also the Christ. Let's take a look at the third point. That is his Christ, that's his Hebrew title. It's his Hebrew title. See, when you think about Christ, the word means anointed one or Messiah. Lord have mercy. See, Lord Jesus Christ is the promised Redeemer that the Jews looked for over thousands of years ago. And when we think of this, we must accept the work of the Redeemer. Listen, I'm excited the fact that in all of eternity past, Jesus, all of my family, I would be the first of my family to be saved. I don't know why he chose me, but I'm so glad he did. Because when I think about my life before him, I was going in the wrong direction. Okay, amen. Y'all looking at me. You were going in the wrong direction too. If it had not been the grace of God, where would we be? Is there anybody in the house that has some grace extended to them? Is there anyone in the house that has some grace extended to them? I know you was born holy and righteous with a halo in the name of Jesus. Even that's a lie, because in Psalm 51:5, he said, we are born in sin and shaped in iniquity. So when we look at this, he says we have to accept his work and we have to trust who he is and what he has done. Lord have mercy. When I think about what he has done, listen, as the Christ, he did some things when he walked amongst the land of the living. One, first of all, he did some miracles. Lord have mercy. You know, when he was in the wilderness, hallelujah to the Lamb. When he was in the wilderness, he had to overcome some things. He had to overcome the temptations in the wilderness. That was a miracle, saints. And he was led there by the Spirit. See, sometimes when you go through, it's not always the enemy that's allowing you to go through that. Sometimes God is navigating circumstances for you to go through because he needs to work out some things in you. It's not always the enemy. When you think about this, after Jesus was baptized in the River Jordan, you find that the heavens opened up and so did hell. After the dove, here comes the devil. See, when you look at what he did, he withstood the temptation of the enemy. He resisted the enemy. Christ did that. He resisted it. And here's the thing. Whenever there's a miracle taking place, trust me, evil is always present. Whenever there's a good deed in the name of the Lord, evil is always present. Don't ever get it twisted. If Satan can go up to the portals of heaven and dialogue with the Lord, as he did in the book of Job, surely he can come into this sanctuary and have a seat. One of his demons can sit right next to you. Y'all ain't praying with me. He can have a seat right next to you. And you find that someone else might get irritated because the praise and worship was going too long. Okay, amen, lights and walls. Have you ever sat next to someone and said, why is there so much of this praise and worship? Isn't it time to, what time is it? When we don't look at the time any other place, but when we come in his house, we want to know the time. Okay, amen. I'm going to move on. When you look at this, the miracle, but also when I think about another thing he did that just stood out for me, many things he did as the Christ. What he did was, if you look at John, the Gospel of John, chapter 5, verse 8 and 9, he healed an impotent man who suffered for 38 years. Jesus said to him, rise, take up your bed and walk. And immediately the man was made well, took up his bed and walked. And that day was the Sabbath. Lord have mercy. See, he said this impotent man was impotent for 38 years. He was impotent for 38 years. How long have you been waiting for that answer prayer? How long have you been going before the Lord asking for an answer? God says it's not predicated on when you want it, it's when I want it. Because as the mature saints used to always say, he may never come when you want him, but he's always on time. Lord have mercy. See, when I think about it, God knows what we have need of. God knows when to give it to us. Because if we get it too soon, we will mess up. So God knows exactly when to give it to us. Lord have mercy. When you think about what he did, he healed this man. See, in the beginning of the situation, you might find he went through it for 38 years. What have you been going through for a long period of time? What have you been fighting for a long period of time? Sometimes even your ailment can translate to not only a withered physical being, but your heart can wither. Because you're waiting for a long period of time. You think the answer ought to have been here. More often than not, when we lift up a prayer before God, sometimes we pray, Lord, you know the light's due tomorrow. You ain't praying with me. We waited to the last minute to pray to him about the situation, but because it's due, we now say, Lord, you know it's due tomorrow. Okay, Lord, they gave me a grace period. I got another week. Okay, Lord, I've been praying. I've been going to church. I've been on the prayer call in the morning. I've been just trying to do it. I've been reading my word. Lord, it's been 2 weeks now. Okay, Lord, I know maybe it's busy in heaven. I know you got a lot going on, Lord. You're tearing for all of humanity, all of the world, Lord. Everything. You're navigating eternity. God, I know you're sovereign. I know you got it, Lord. It's been 3 weeks now. Lord. Woo! Lord, it's going on a month now, Lord. Ain't you got this? Let me see if I can call someone. I need some help. More often than not, we would have jumped in to situations when God needs to say, just be still. When you've done all you know to do, then stand still. You have a part in the process, but do your part and then stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. See, my part in looking for gainful employment means I'm going to fill out online applications. Once I do that, I'm going to stand still. What I need to go running around trying to brag, you know, bother people about, can you put my name in your company? No, I'm going to fill it out online and have faith to believe that God going to open the door. And I can tell you as a living testament that he has done that since I've been down here in Charlotte, North Carolina. With my experience, I thought when I came from Pennsylvania working with Kroger as a performance consultant, talent management, OD leader, I thought I knew unequivocally when I came to Charlotte, I was getting a full-time job. Y'all ain't praying with me. What? My background, my experience, I know I got this thing. They said Charlotte was up and coming, it's busting. I got this thing. I'm going to fill out my, what? I like that position. Let me see what's going on with that. Nothing. Nothing. Wait a minute. 2 weeks go by, filling out online apps for positions I can do with my eyes closed. Nothing. Wait a minute now. You're getting a little crazy. I called my boys back in Pennsylvania, Pastor Scott, Pastor Troy. I said, yo, man, it's getting rough down here. I thought I'd be employed. And Troy had the audacity to say, that's because God got something else for you, man. I ain't want to hear that. I need a salary. Y'all ain't praying. I'm just trying to be honest. Is there any honest folks in the house? Okay, amen, lights and walls. Don't look at me like I'm crazy. I'm just be honest. I need a salary. Because every one of us here needs some money, baby. I said, everybody in here needs some money. If you don't need no money, then give me what you got. Leave it right here at the altar. And he said, maybe God's got something else for you, Kev. You just got to wait. Well, 2 months go by, 3 months go by. Some of them don't even respond. And then one finally did respond. I'm going to call them out. Charlotte Water. I am. They say, listen, we like what you see. We want you to fill out this quick proposal. Here's a solution. We want to find out what your answer is. I did all the work, knocked the ball out the park. So we want to grant you an interview. But we want you to bring some of your training materials you produced, and we want you to actually facilitate a small session of it. Ain't no problem, got this. Actually went in, did it, knocked the ball out the park. So I'm good. Then I remember getting the call, and the call came through. You ain't praying with me. And they started out and said, you know what, Mr. Richardson, you did a phenomenal job. It was outstanding. But, okay. When they said, but, I ain't hear nothing else that lady said. I didn't hear a thing. I heard, but canceled out everything she said. You did a great job. Your proposal was outstanding. The people loved you. But we went with an internal person. But we like you so much. If there was a consulting opportunity that we had, would you consider doing it? I won't do nothing for y'all. Because if the truth be told, my heart was troubled. I said, Lord, I know you didn't bring me down here to be left unemployed. When I had a job with an organization that employed over 472,000 employees, I know you didn't bring me down here for this. God says, be still. And I remember one night, as in an apartment in the residential housing before the house was built, before we transitioned to Ansley Falls and things of that nature, and I remember I was by myself. And I remember I was reading and studying. And I remember I went through a cleansing process where the Lord spoke to Kevin Richardson and told me I just need to trust him. And it was a deep cleansing for me where I wept before the Lord because he had to know my heart. God, you know where I am. God, you know the obligations. God, you know where it need to be. But God, I know you got it. And before you know it, a full-time job did not open. What God did was open up a consulting gig. And guess what? That's how he provided. The Lord, I said, the Lord provided consulting opportunities where I was able to earn 10 times more if I had been employed by any one of them companies. Y'all ain't praying with me. Wait a minute, you want to pay me how much an hour to do that consulting? Oh, let me think about it. That's enough. I'll take it. It was nothing but the blessings of the Lord. He said, can you trust me, Kevin? Can you trust me? You trust me when you was up in Pennsylvania. You trust me when you was traveling across the country teaching. You trust me when you was up there. Can you trust me now down here in the desert, in the pit? Can you trust me? The Spirit of the Lord is saying the same thing for some of you. Can you trust him when you're in the pit? Or can you only praise him when you're in a palace? See, God says in this title, Christ, he is that Hebrew title. He is the anointed one. God, shower me with some of that anointing. That when people come into my presence, that they don't see me, but they see you. And when you look at what he did, he says truly that when you think about how he redeemed us from all iniquity, which means that we're no longer a master or serving that master. He did that for you and I. If I look at this thing of what he did for us, he says to us that when you're changed, he said, because he redeemed you, because he is the Christ, he is the Messiah, the Redeemer. He says he's given you salvation that changed your position, which sets us free from the slavery and bondage of sin. That's what God does. And so when you look at what he does, he said, but it don't change. Stop there. He changes our attitude. He changes our appetite. He changes our ambition. And he also changes our action. Listen, when you look at what he does, God knows through his grace how to get us where we need to be. Because God says, as Christians, we are in this present age. We live in the world, but we should not live like it or for it. We should live like it or for it. So when people see us, they ought to see something different from the world. If people struggle to see a difference between us and the world, that's a problem, saints. Because he said, be in the world, but not of the world. Be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. You can tell when you get on a job, what are you allowing yourself to be pulled into verbally? Because you do know it's easier to be tear down than to build up. God says the Christ title as the Redeemer lets us know when we call on his full title, the Lord Jesus Christ, there's some things that's going to happen. Lord have mercy. When I look at what's going to happen, first and foremost, he said, when we result in the believing of Christ, the Lord Jesus Christ, the one thing that Paul and Silas said to the jailer, they said, if you believe on that, he said, thou shall be saved. Lord have mercy. Every one of us had to do that. I said, everyone had to do that. You had to call on the Lord Jesus Christ to be saved. And God chose you. The Son purchased you and the Holy Ghost sealed you into the day of redemption. And so when they did all of that for you and I, we ought to call on his name. Listen, when I think about this, when you look at the language, the way it's worded in Acts, he says literally the passive voice of the Greek grammatical structure emphasizes the fact that the jailer realized I couldn't do it myself. He said, I lack the capacity to save myself. Don't ever think that you pulled yourself up by your own bootstraps to come serve the Lord. We were never looking for the Lord. He was always looking for us. And the truth be told, he's still looking for some of us. Because we come with a form of godliness, but we're still denying the power thereof. When you look at what he says here, he says, you might be saved. He didn't say when you're talking about salvation, it was definitive. He said, thou shall be saved. Thou shall be saved. Call on the Lord Jesus Christ. Thou shall be saved. When I call it, he didn't say you might be saved. You might have a lucky shot. He said, you didn't say that I had a hope so salvation. No, the word of God lets us know that when we accept him, that we can fully trust in the fact that we know that I am saved. When you look at 1 John chapter 5, verse 13, he tells us clearly, these things have I written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life and that you may continue to believe in the name of the Son of God. That name is above every name. That name is the Lord Jesus Christ. When you think about salvation, when you think about what God has done for us, we ought to get excited every time we're given an opportunity to come in his house to worship him because of what he did. If he don't do nothing else for you and I, he has done enough. Simply because he has saved your soul. Listen, when I think about what I used to be, Lord have mercy, all you got to do is think about what you used to be. Go back for a moment. Don't go back and stay there, but go back and remember from whence he brought you. What I used to do, what I used to say, what I used to be like. God says, you're moving over in this direction now. God said, you may not have arrived, but at least you're not what I used to be. And I'm progressing to the prize of the mark of the high calling. How many of us are striving? How many of us are pressing? How many of us are looking for the change in the name of Jesus? We got to know that God's got our back. And we got to be able to recognize that that title is powerful. There is something in that name. I said, there is something in that name. I said, there is something in that name. When I call on the Lord Jesus Christ, I see healing occurring. When I call on the Lord Jesus Christ, there's deliverance that's going to occur. When I call on the Lord Jesus Christ, there's some holiness that's going to be imparted. When I call on the Lord Jesus Christ, there's some righteousness that's going to be imparted. When I call on the Lord Jesus Christ, there's some, see, y'all ain't praying with me. When I think about what God is doing, think about what he's doing in your own personal experience right now. That's enough to make you shout. Because you were not always in his house on a Sunday morning. Okay, every one of us under the sound of my voice is an ex-something. And God said, in spite of that, I still want you. In spite of what you used to be, I still wanted you. Lord have mercy. I'm so grateful to God that in spite of me, he still chose me. And because of that, I can face tomorrow. Listen, it's not predicated on my situation. It's not predicated on my circumstance. I can still serve the Lord. I can still worship the Lord. I can still lift up holy hands. I can still dance before the Lord. I can still sing his songs of praise. I can still walk and dance for him because I did it for the world. That didn't do nothing for us. How much more? I said, how much more shall we do for him that saved your soul in the name of Jesus? See, I'm just looking for some folks that recognize where God brought you from. I said, I'm just looking for a few honest folks in the house. See, if God ain't delivered, if you were born with a halo, then it's not for you. But this is for some of us that struggled. This is some of us that did some things, said some things, been places that we shouldn't have been. And guess what? God says, I still got your back. I still love you. I'm still going to make a way for you. I know you messed up, but come here. Come here. Let me love you right now. Let me wrap my arms of love around you. In the name of Jesus. When you look at what God is doing, When you look at how he's doing it, you got to call on his name, the Lord Jesus Christ, and watch him move in a magnificent way. You heard the praise team sing, signs and wonders, miracles. I said miracles. I want to see the blind healed. I want to see the lame, those who are physically impaired, to be able to walk. I want to see it in my face right here in this sanctuary. Because the power that raised Jesus from the dead is the same power that's in us. And that's something to get excited about. That same resurrected power. God said there's some things dead in your life, but there's about to be a resurrection in the name of Jesus. God says there's some things that you need. God said the breakthrough is about to happen in the name of Jesus. I don't know who needs it, but I'm telling you, God is going to make a way out of no way. But the question is, can we trust him? Can we lean into him? Can we thank him enough? Can you thank him on credit for what he's going to do for you? In the name of Jesus. Lord have mercy. When I think of his goodness, when I think about his goodness and all that he's done for us, our souls ought to cry out, hallelujah to the Lamb. It ought to cry out. Crying out, saints. God wants us to know that we need to reverence him for who he is. We ought to acknowledge his deity. We ought to acknowledge his humanity. And we ought to acknowledge him being the redeemer of humanity. Because he's just more than just a friend. When you say we got a friend in Jesus, yeah, he's more, much more than that. And we want to acknowledge him for just that, that he's much more than what they say he was. And so we want to honor God every chance we get because he wants the absolute best for you, the absolute best. The question is, are you willing to accept what he has to give? Are you willing to accept what he has to give? There's some things that we have to let go. There's some things we have to embrace. There's some things we have to walk away from. There's some things we got to walk to. God says, can you trust me? Or are you trying to take control? Or are you trying to take control? The Spirit of the Lord would have us to know that he can and will get us where we need to be. But the problem is, we got to be willing to surrender. We have to be willing to surrender. See, people came to this altar because it was about worship, praise. God will say to us that it's time to stop playing church. We don't come in with form or fashion. We're not coming to impress the person next to me based on what I have on. Lord, I got a need. I need a breakthrough. I need a touch from the Lord. That has to be our story. But we are so distracted with a lot of self-talk in our mind that we're even missing the word that's coming from the pulpit. Are we too busy to sit down a cell phone for a few moments just so we can hear what he has to say? God says it's time to stop playing. Because saints of God, it's serious. When you look at what he's doing in our midst, signs and wonders and miracles. Let me tell you, saints, last Sunday, God moved in a powerful way. He moved in such a powerful way that we had the altar opened for prayer. And while you were in the midst of praying, God moved in the heart of someone online. And that person called the phone line and said, I call to accept Jesus as my Savior. And not only did they call, they said, I need the Savior. But they called and said, I want to be a member of that church. See, that's something to get excited about. I said, that's something to get excited about. I want to try to recall her name because I vaguely remember, because not only did she call, accept Christ and say, I want to be a member of this church, but she was also on Midweek Word at 7 o'clock on Wednesday. Her first name was Kimberly. Her first name was Kimberly. Think Smith. If she's in the midst, amen. My sister, listen, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Sis, I don't mean to put you on spot. I don't mean to put you on spot, sis. But I want to ask you if you come down here just with me for a second. Just come down here with me for a second. Because what we want to do is we want to honor you. We want to celebrate you. Hallelujah. I said that's something to get excited about. We thank God for you. We don't want to put you on the spot. We just want to celebrate you because of what you did. You responded to the move of the Holy Ghost. And that's a miracle. That's a miracle. In the name of Jesus. Glory to you. This is your brothers and sisters in the Lord. Just look around, your brothers and sisters. This is your family now. Your family. Celebrate your family. Celebrate your sister. My. See, that's why I tell you, when the invitation is going forward, pray, saints. It ain't no time to be looking around. Pray. A soul is hanging in the balance. It would have been unheard of in times past, where people were calling in to this branch of Zion, surrendering, wanting to be a part of. You have a person that said one time, I want to be baptized. And the member came to me and shared that with me. I said, really? I said, yeah. Well, where's the person? They live in New York. All right. We don't do virtual baptisms. They said, it's all right. They're willing to catch a flight to come down here to be baptized. I'm telling you, saints, the hand of the Lord is moving in our midst. That's the signs and the wonders and the miracles that are occurring. I want to see it, saints. I don't want to just read it. I want to see it. How about you? Listen, saints of God, as we did, we want everyone to know that the Lord says that it's not my will that man should perish, but that all would come to the saving knowledge of who he is, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ, accepting his sacrifice at Calvary's cross. At this point in our service, I want to extend an invitation to someone under the sound of my voice or online in the name of Jesus. Listen. God says that I've never invited you to go to hell, but I have invited you and open up the door of heaven, and you can have that, but you got to trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. Salvation is the first call. You've never trusted Jesus as your Savior. You've never trusted in his name. This is an opportunity for you to call on that number, 704-522-6480, extension 120 or 173. Saints of God are praying. When you pray, things will move. When you pray, there's a breakthrough. Shackles will fall off when you're praying. If there's someone under the sound of my voice that needs salvation, you don't know if you're going to heaven. You doubt whether or not you're going to. If that's you, you need to meet us right here at this altar. Don't gamble with your eternity. Don't gamble with your life, because this day you can choose life or you can choose death. You can choose the Savior or you can choose to be eternally separated from him. God says today is the day of salvation. Is there one for salvation? Online, if that's you, you're watching us, you're looking, you're trying to figure it out. Listen, God will tell you, you know what? Don't try to figure it out. Move, call that number, and make a decision and watch God move on your behalf. If that's you, the first call is for salvation. You need to know him, but you don't know him. Listen, all you have to do is to do what they said in Romans. First of all, he said in Romans 3:23, all have come short of his glory. Every one of us have failed in his eyesight. And then he said in Romans 6:23, he said, the wages of sin is death. That's eternal death. Eternal death, not the physical death. See, if you're born once, you'll die twice. If you're born twice, you only die once. But he said, the gift of God is eternal life. It's eternal life. If that's you, you need to know the Lord. You don't know him. You need to come. You need to come. Don't deliberate. Don't pontificate. Don't even dialogue with yourself. Talk. You need to just come. That's you online. Call that number. 704-522-6480. Extension 120 or 173. Someone is waiting on the other end of that line to talk with you about your decision. While you're doing that, while you're pondering, the first call is for salvation. The second call is for restoration, rededication. You need to rededicate your life to the Lord. You know the Lord, you trusted him, but you walked away, or you're in a backslidden state. Listen, all of us have that testimony for the most part. Some of us, most of us may have walked away from the Lord one time in our life. If that's you, you need to come. You need to be restored. You need to restore the fellowship with your Father. Listen, your eternity is secured, but your fellowship is broken. If you walked away from him, we need to restore that. If that's you, I want you to meet us right here at this altar. Meet us right here at this altar. If that's you on that line, you need to be responding. Respond right away. It's a personal choice. You have to do it. The Lord will never force you, and neither will I. It's a personal decision. But the consequences is what you'll have to deal with. Because the Bible says we're not guaranteed tomorrow. We don't know what tomorrow is going to bring forth. That's why I would say to you, don't worry about yesterday and don't worry about tomorrow, because you can't change nothing on either of those days. If that's you, first two calls out there for the invitation. It's salvation. You need to know him. You don't know him. The second call is for restoration. You need to rededicate your life to the Lord. It's time to rededicate. It's time to get back into the fold. It's time to start serving the Lord Almighty. While you're thinking about that, while you're concentrating on that, the last call is for church affiliation. You need a church home. You need to know where you can come and fellowship with the saints of God. We open up the doors of Nation Fork Community Church. If that's you, we want to welcome you to be part of our family, as our sister Kimberly Smith was. We welcome them. Even if you're online, we're going to celebrate you just the same. Call that phone line. Call that number. Again, 704-522-6480, extension 120 and 173. If that's you, you need to come. You need to come. If that's you, in the name of Jesus, if that's you, you need to come. Hallelujah to the Lamb. When you think about what God is doing, when you think about how God is moving, saints of God, you want to celebrate the Lord in the name of Jesus. I said you want to celebrate the Lord in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Hallelujah to the Lamb. My. Amen. Listen. It's Dwight, right? It's Dwight in the name of Jesus. Listen, Dwight already joined us. He's already a member. He's already got some family here. We got his family, because when I spoke to him, he did say, I'm going to bring my whole family. He's doing what a Joshua would say. As for me and my house. Y'all ain't praying with me. He said, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Can we get excited, saints? A man of God brings his family to God. My. My brother did say, he said, Pastor Kevin, everything good. He said, but Pastor, I'm coming back, I'm bringing my whole family. Amen. We thank the Lord that he's bringing the whole family. I said, the whole family. I said, the whole family. He didn't keep it to himself. He went back and got the whole family. Bless the Lord for that. Is there anyone else? Anyone else? that want to come, the altar is still open for salvation. You need to know him. You don't know him. For restoration, you walked away from him, but you need to come. Then there's church affiliation. You need to be a member of a household of worship under God-given authority, following and leading what the Bible tells us to do in the name of Jesus. See, all the families out there are not broken. All of the families out there are still serving the Lord in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Listen, I know you got the kids, you're home. Look, you like me. I remember mine was okay, home too long. In the name of Jesus. Listen, we want to pray for this family. If you're online, don't forget to call that number, 704-522-6480, extension 120 or 173. We want to pray for this family, saints, that God will meet the needs of this family and that God will use this as a powerful example of what he can do. Because as he told the jailer, thou shalt be saved and your whole house in the name of Jesus. I said your whole house. If you would, saints, let's point our hands this way to this family, my brothers Dwight and his family. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Father, for this day. God, our hearts are just overjoyed. We can't thank you enough, my Father, for what you have done. Thank you for my brother that he did a Joshua on him. He said, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And God, he did what he said do in Acts 16:31. He said, I can be saved, but so can my whole household. God, in the name of Jesus, bless this family. Meet every need according to your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. I pray right now, Lord, that you bless the little girls. You bless the little guy. God, meet them right where they are. Because, Father, they're here because you have a purpose. God, there's a mission. I pray that you make it plain and clear for each and every one of them, my Father. And then, God, as the children continue to come, let them embrace the Children Worship Center. Let them get that word, Lord. Let it germinate within them that, God, that they'll grow up to be well-balanced disciples themselves. Father, when it's all said and done, we're going to be ever so careful to give you the honor, to give you the praise, because truly it's in Jesus' mighty name we pray with thanksgiving. All hearts and minds said amen, 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 and amen. My brother Dwight, if you would, if you walk over here to our altar greeters, take them over there, Frank D, and let them see the altar greeters. This is going to get a little bit of information from you. Amen. Let's give your God a hand clap of praise. My, my, my. My, my, my. I said, Lord, only God, only God. Signs and wonders, miracles. Signs and wonders, miracles. Only God can move on the heart of a man and then cause a transformation in his heart that he goes back and tells his wife and his children, we're going to the household of worship. That's signs and wonders. Because more often than not, it's not the men that are doing that. It's the ladies that's doing that. Thank God for what he's doing in our midst, saints. Give your God a hand clap of praise.